Today we're talking about the story on everybody's mind right now. This Thursday, the White House released plans to finally pass through their improved US-Mexico-Canada free trade deal through Congress. That's right, we're finally gonna have improved free trade with Mexico, said everybody who read that article and immediately stopped watching or reading any news and turned their phone to airplane mode. A few hours later, we saw the White House shifting their tone from free trade to somewhat more expensive trade. There was an official tweet about imposing a 5% tariff June 10th, and everybody just lost their collective minds, including the media, who uttered a phrase I never want to hear again.
She joins us from the White House to break down that tweet. There's a lot in there, Kayla.
Man, I've never felt more like my job could be done by a teenage girl and snooky news team. It was people reading through his tweets like they were preparing for an English final that brings us to today and all of the uncertainty. First, I'm a little iffy on whether this is a relevant story because the primary source everybody is citing is the president's Twitter feed. And yeah, okay. I mean, sad statement on our reality, but remember the times when everybody lost their collective minds over his tweet to close the southern border? And that didn't happen. In fact, after he backed down from the border closure threat, he threatened to put tariffs on Mexico. Although we all promptly forgot about that. When was that again? Oh, like 2 months ago? According to the Washington Examiner, a source with a right-of-center bias and a high rate of factual reporting, in case you, like me, aren't too familiar with them, on several previous occasions, Trump has threatened tariff hikes only to back off before the deadline. It's not just that, Trump's Twitter foreign policy doesn't have a great track record. US troops are still in Syria, North Korea is still a nuclear threat, and we thankfully haven't yet abandoned our Kurdish allies. Now, I'm not trying to rip on Trump here, I'm trying to rip on the media, because, oh man, you guys really love talking about Trump's tweets. To be fair, we did recently see
President Trump raised the stakes for talks yesterday, tweeting that tariffs on $200 billion in Chinese goods would more than double on Friday to 25%, which would effectively end a six-month truce with Beijing.
And that really did happen a week later, so who knows? I think we're batting at about a 10% right now. Now with that massive preamble, let's get to the amble. What would happen if this is one of the times he's not blowing smoke? On June 10th, the United States will impose a 5% tariff on all goods coming into our country from Mexico, until such time as illegal migrants coming through Mexico and into our country stop. The tariff will gradually increase until the illegal migration problem is remedied, at which time the tariffs will be removed. Details from the White House to follow. Well, they haven't followed as of this report, but I guess I'll make like everybody else and analyze the president's tweet. Why couldn't I have started this channel under Bush? What's going to happen if we do this? Well, the first thing that comes to my mind is
it comes at a peculiar time, just as the US, Canada, and Mexico are putting the finishing touches on their revamped NAFTA deal, now known as the USMCA, or the United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement. Canada launched the ratification process on Wednesday, and yesterday the Trump administration followed suit by kickstarting the approval process with Congress. It also comes after the US lifted steel and aluminium tariffs on its neighbors earlier this month in order to speed up this ratification.
I've been tracking the constant battle over the last year to negotiate this free trade agreement and try to get it voted into law. And if we do this, well, then I'm gonna have to start reading Dante's Inferno to keep reporting this story, because it's going to a far corner of legislative hell. I mean, this action is just weird in this context. Still though, might happen. The second question in my mind is, how legally could this be implemented? Well, I'm not sure if you've heard, but there's an emergency going on our southern border. Yep, that's still a thing. Enter the 1977 International Emergency Economic Powers Act. Oh man, I think you know where this one is going. This is where things would get truly hilarious if I was in another country or analyzing this as a TV show. This act was passed to amend the Trading with the Enemy Act. So sorry, Mexico, but for the purposes of legally implementing these tariffs, yeah, you're the enemy. Wanna sign this trade deal now? You can't make this stuff up. This is why, in defending these tariffs, people have to talk like...
The statute being invoked here is the International Emergency Economic Powers Act. It requires two things. One, a national emergency. Clearly, we have that at the border. Two, it requires a threat to our economy, our foreign policy, or our national security. Clearly, yes, we have that as well.
According to Wikipedia, this emergency protocol is currently being used 31 times, so not exactly rare. This would be the first time we'd use it for tariffs, though. Probably because saying you're gonna put a 10% tariffs on all products exported from Al-Qaeda operatives wouldn't go well. We'd probably end up having a debate over how it's gonna drive up oil prices or something. Until now, we've used it to freeze assets of terrorist organizations, the Iranian government, and exactly zero entities that would surprise you at all. Now though, move over North Korea because Mexico's going on the list. So why could the country of Mexico soon be classified as an enemy to the United States in this legislation? Well,
Mexico, by being a bystander in this criminal enterprise, is imposing enormous costs on the United States, on our welfare system, on our criminal justice system.
Now, the actual enemy, if you listen to the director of the Office of Trade and Manufacturing Policy, Peter Navarro, is the legitimately awful smuggling operation bringing people into the country. The traditional application of this act would be to freeze their assets. Remember though, these tariffs aren't punishing the smugglers, but rather Mexico. Could you imagine the ethics of putting tariffs on the smugglers?
If you look at it from an investor's point of view and a corporate point of view, what we have in Mexico is the export, one of the high exports of illegal aliens, and it's a criminal enterprise.
Illegally exporting people into America. Well, Uncle Sam's gonna need his gut. How does a 5% tariff sound? You keep doing it, we're gonna raise that to 25%. Our bald eagle needs to wet its beak. So because there's an emergency at the border and Mexico is attacking our economy and government systems through inaction, we might be able to put tariffs on all imported Mexican goods. Whew, boy, if we ever actually decide to do this, there is no way that it's not going to be a very interesting court case I end up reporting on. To go a little deeper, we actually have seen a huge spike in border crossings. I mean, we're talking a return to pre-recession levels. So, well, I guess America might have been made great again. Because these are mostly asylum seekers from Central America, people seem to think America has three demands. First, build a southern border wall. And I'm not talking US-Mexico. Go a little more south. Mexico-Guatemala. Yes, America wants this so badly, Mexico could probably build a border wall with Guatemala and get us to pay for it. Since it's a narrower border and most of the new immigrants aren't actually Mexican anymore, this would probably be a cheaper and more efficient solution. The second thing we're demanding is, remember, this new brand of migrants are as undocumented in Mexico as they are in America. We want Mexico to take the leash off their ICE officers and expand their programs. As of now, their immigration enforcement policies have been pretty inconsistent and seem to mostly rise and fall in accordance to the general vibe of how the public is feeling at the time. Last month we saw...
These Central American migrants are being chased by Mexican immigration agents. In coordination with federal police, immigration officials now appear to be adopting a more aggressive approach toward migrants entering through Mexico's southern border.
So it's in an upswing right now, and America wants to keep it that way. Because they can be deported before they get to America, where we guarantee due process to everybody who's in our jurisdiction. See my episode on the Supreme Court case of Zedvidas v. Davis if that last statement sounds incorrect to you. Finally, we want to keep these asylum seekers in Mexico until their day in court. Our current Remain in Mexico strategy is making its way through the court system. It's being appealed after Donald Trump's favorite district court, the Northern District Court of California, ruled that it violates the Immigration and Nationality Act, the Administrative Procedure Act, and international human rights laws, and of course the law of just frickin' common sense, to send asylum seekers to dangerous places while they await their asylum claims. Now, it's more complicated than that, and trust me, you can go chasing threads about administrative laws governing contiguous countries, but the sticking point we'll be trying to resolve today in this episode is asylum seekers and violent waiting rooms can't mix. Because of this, and the first time Trump has ever been concerned about creating a safe space, the US is trying to get Mexico an official designation as a safe third country, apparently operating on the hope that nobody has ever heard a Trump speech. The problem is, Mexico won't sign any documents that would allow us to dump thousands of asylum seekers onto them, because as their foreign minister said, a safe third country status would turn Mexico into a final destination for immigrants, and would invalidate any further bid for asylum in the United States. That's why we've rejected it. Yeah, America kind of figured that one out. That's why we're trying to get you to sign it. So now to the part most people are fixating on in this story.
What does this mean for US consumers?
Yeah, this is probably going to be obnoxious to people with more money than me, as the price of car parts and avocados go up. Our imports from Mexico are huge and diverse, and I'm no fortune teller. Believe me, if I was, I'd have more money. So I'm not going to try and predict the results of these potential tariffs. Just know that if you charge an additional 5% on all of this, well, prices probably aren't going to go down. Unless you want to cite the specific example of the 30% tariffs we put on Chinese solar panels. Turns out they were overcharging us so much that the price might soon be cheaper than it was before those tariffs. Point here is, the direct effects of tariffs are really, really hard to predict, so I'm not going to waste your time. Well, I think I've covered the who, what, when, where, why, and how pretty thoroughly at this point. Mexico's president is currently in America right now because, hey, sometimes people follow through on threats they post online. We'll see if on June 10th Trump actually follows up on this threat, or if this entire thing was just another waste of time Twitter rant that we all took way too seriously. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.